I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And our dearest Frieda here today, this temple, find me at rest, at peace. Frieda's not here. She's in glory. One day we should all enjoy the wonderful words of the angel. He is not here. He is risen. Frieda is not here. She is risen. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. The only gate and the way to achieve that is to pass from this life to the next. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of the sin is law. But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not going to seal Frieda in a tomb, because death can't hold us. When you know Jesus, as Frieda and Clive, when we were here only 9 months ago, know Jesus, not you Jesus, they know him, for they have just passed on from here into eternity, where I pray each one of us shall also congregate one day if the Lord should tarry. So Frieda, we say goodbye till we meet again. Congregation can please stand. Now I'm going to ask my Uncle Pete if he would commit this service to the Lord, even as we've gathered here together to pay our last respects. So let's bow our heads. Thank you, Uncle Pete.
Holy Spirit, that you would move in this meeting, that your presence would just overshadow each one of us, that you bring the comfort and peace to those that are in need, or touch our hearts, bring encouragement to us, I pray. We ask for anointing upon the service, for our brother Eric Morgan's
First of all, thank you, family, friends, for being with us here today to remember our beloved Frieda, and to support Clive and Frieda's wonderful children and grandchildren through this very, very difficult time. At the tomb of Lazarus, Jesus wept. So don't feel ashamed or bad if the Most High God could weep the death of a saint. But it's just a temporary loss here, because Frieda lives on. Jesus wept for our grief, and we weep with the family in your loss. For those who could not make it, and there is some family who can't, we haven't done live streaming today, as become accustomed, but Earl will prepare a video and share it with those who wish to review it. It is just a short while ago, on the 23rd of December, that we gathered here to pay our respects to Clive. And this beautiful picture depicts so much what we shared and heard at that service. A couple deeply in love, today united. Yes, you can tell me the Bible says there's no giving and taking of a marriage, because God doesn't want squabbles in heaven. But that friends and loved ones should be united in the power and might of the Most High God. And so Clive and Frieda are together. The tune of O Danny Boy, over the pipes are calling, calling Frieda to come home. Come home, for this was Clive and Frieda's desire, to live together forever in their Father's house. Now it reminds you that Jesus said these wonderful words: let not your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And where I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Where I am, there ye may be also. That's where they are, rejoicing in the Heavenly Father, in the wonderfulness of their salvation. And where Jesus goes, they now know, and they know the way. For Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Be comforted, my friends, in these scriptures. To the family, Cindy, Byron, Jade, Aaron, to Earl, Sekhasen, Sekatsen. Oh, I'm going to get that right. I had to practice it on Thursday. To Devon, and Nicole, and little Hannah. I think it's only on these two sad occasions that Sandy, my wife, and I were able to meet you. And I'm sorry, but because of our lives and our communities and where we live, far from one another, it is so. First, at your mom and dad's home in Bosmont when Dad passed. And then again in Northcliffe on the passing of a dear mom. And yet, I feel I've known you for years. And how can I say that? It's because of the wonderful Christ-like nature and character that reflects of your mom and dad through your lives, through your hearts, through your souls. It's just like they're stood here because of your hearts. And I think that is the most wonderful testimony to a mom and dad and to Frieda, who wanted to be with her family when she passed. And you allowed it. That's wonderful. That is so wonderful. And so, may our association be long and continue beyond today, until one day we're all gathered across that river. Our heart and love goes out to you all as a family. A family that has been so wonderfully influenced by two precious saints. A mom and dad who loved you dearly, brought you up the best they could, and taught you to love Jesus. And not only taught you to love Jesus, but to show you to find your own way, your own relationship with him. Your dearest mom and dad were so warm, welcoming and loving, just as you are, and memories will never fade. Mom Frieda was, or should I say no, is, because this is not the end of life. The day you got saved was the beginning of eternity. This is just the passing from this pilgrimage to a much better life. And so Mom is such a warm and loving person, a very, very kind person. We ministered in the home, in the hospital, and shared much fellowship here at church. Of course, we probably, as outside members of a family, knew all the good traits of Mom. But I can't imagine a Frieda with an unkind thought, a good heart. I'm sure Frieda would put you in your place. Just checking the kids that, yeah. A firm hand. A wonderful woman. A strong woman. A lady in Christ. Anchored. Knew her mind. Knew Jesus. And so this faith has been passed on, and I said to the family, Mom and Dad are gone now. The torch has been passed to you, and your children will be sitting where you are today in many years to come. But I just love it that the love of Christ is passed on from generation to generation, and that their memories and freedom will live on in this family till you all meet again. Remember Mom well for all Mom was to you, and let me assure you, she still is. Her physical presence today will be laid to rest, but Mom will live on in your hearts and minds, and our hearts and minds, till we too are called to glory. Mom is now in her father's house with your dad forever. You will see her again. The Lord bless you all in your time of mourning. And you must mourn. And you must cry. It's important. And you must rejoice and remember and sing the songs of gladness, which I believe we're going to sing today. I don't know these songs that Fred has chosen, but you're getting them today. To the extended family and friends, it's an honor and a privilege that Frieda too asked to be buried from this church, the last congregation which her and Clive served as their home. But I know there's pastors probably here and folk from other fellowships, because after all, the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ is one body. We might be meeting in different places, but we're one. But for us, it's a great pleasure to hold this last earthly service here in this earthly sanctuary and this place of worship. For us as family and friends to share in our own grief and with the family and to mourn our great loss too. To be succored for everybody by the Holy Spirit in the sure hope of our eternal life. And to pay our respects to this wonderful lady who today worships her God and her Saviour. Our God and Saviour. The great I Am. The God and Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of Jesus Christ the righteous, and of the blessed Holy Spirit, and the God and Father of Freda Govensabby. I could preach a long sermon to you on hellfire and damnation. Whatever else. I could speak precious words of wisdom today, but I can never match the beauty and the consolation and the love and the assurances that are in these holy scriptures. The scriptures that Frieda and Clive based their lives on. And so I want to share a few more with you. For Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth on me shall never die. I want to read to you from Thessalonians, the scripture which will be our joy and our gladness when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them who are asleep. Not dead, asleep. That ye sorrow not, even as others who have no hope. The scriptures are not telling us not to sorrow. It's not saying that. Sorrow, but as one with hope, one with assurance that as Frieda trusted her Lord and Savior to the very end and didn't accuse him or rail upon him for an illness or anything like that, such a gracious woman throughout her cancer, long before we even knew about it, have that hope. It's an eternal hope. Sorrow, yes, but sorrow with hope and joy in your hearts that we will see Frieda again. For if ye believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. And if he's going to bring her with him, where is she? She is there in his presence already. These mortal remains will just be reunited one day. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede them who are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. When that trumpet sounds, oh, what a glorious day. I pray that you all will be there too. We're going to sing a song, share a song, sing a sing. Hahona, is that what it's called? And folk, it's a vibey song. It's a joyous song. It's a song to praise the Lord Jesus. Free of his choice. All the songs today. So that's why we're not playing the piano today, because we've got these recorded. So I think we can stand. And who's going to play it? Clarence. And if you know the words, sing along. I don't know them, so let's go.
Wonderful. Praise the Lord. Let's be seated. Where's my darling? We have a new song for the youth. I'm sorry, I couldn't sing to that, but I'm like those who sing the national anthem. In course he's but that's beautiful. That's beautiful. What language? Sotho Swana. Internationally South Africa, or should I say provincially South Africa. There is no one like Jesus. What joy. What celebration. So uplifting. This is what Frieda wanted. She wanted us to be happy because she's happy today in Jesus. And so thank you, Frieda. You've given us a new song for Emmanuel Church Youth because we've got such an international crowd there from DRC, Zimbabwe, South Africa, every province. And they're going to teach us that song in church. It's wonderful. Praise the Lord. And you have to play that. Wonderful. Thank you for that, and thank you for entering in. That's wonderful. We're going to hear from Earl. We're going to speak on behalf of the family as he speaks for his mom. Lord bless you.
Morning, family and friends. Thank you everyone for coming. If the song was too jivey for you, I apologize.
No way.
But this was my mom. She was always asking for some African beat. And she would say, oh, when you so stiff yesterday. I think I'm still a little bit stiff. It's biblical. The word of God says, let them praise his name with dancing. Amen. In Ecclesiastes it says there's a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. In Psalms it says, you have turned my mourning into dancing. Mom wanted us to rejoice as much as we mourn. Because she wanted us to celebrate her life. And when you do know what God has done for you, you are guaranteed to dance unashamedly. Firstly, on behalf of the family, I just want to say a few words. And I know that, especially towards the end, that some of you may feel like you were robbed of the chance to see Mom, because it became more difficult for her in her last moments. And we just want to reassure you that that didn't mean that she loved you less, or that it meant anything other than she chose a dignity and she chose a privacy. So thank you for respecting that and allowing her to pass on her own terms. So she wanted the last chapter to be dignified, and we had to respect, which is strange because normally she would put the wishes of others above her own. And it makes no sense if you knew her. You know, she always put others above herself, always willing to be accommodating towards others, with one exception, a family. That is where she often drew the line. She was always more concerned about her husband and her kids and the values that were being established in that home and the love that was in that home. Just before she passed away, 1 or 2 days before she passed, I went to visit her and I looked at Mom. And she looked at me and she said, haven't you eaten? You must be hungry. Do you want something to eat? And I looked down in front and I'm like, I'm looking at how thin this woman is. Because she can't eat. And I said, Mom, people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. She smiled. And that's so typical of a loving mother, you know, wanting to take care of her family before herself. My brother Devin and my sister Cindy, they knew it was going to be difficult for all of us, and they said, Earl, is there anything that we can do for you? I said, do the eulogy. I said, you can ask, but Because we all know that having to condense the life of someone that you love into a few minutes, it's an impossible task. It's like extracting all of the water out of a glass of Oros just to have the orange part. So we're not even going to try to do that here today. Instead, let us reflect on a life and what she meant to us. I was meditating and thinking, if I had to summarize the overall theme of my mom's life, what would that be? And I didn't have to think too long, because I just had to remember who she was, what she did, how she approached life. And that theme is love through sacrifice. That was the theme of her very existence. That is who she was. Mom was born to Opa Musa and Oma Finch. Mom's name was supposed to be Farida Kasim. And after a mix-up at Home Affairs, which I don't think was the last one, her name came back as Frida, which is both fortunate and a contradiction. It was fortunate because it reflected a free-spirited nature. Mom loved adventure. She loved exploring nature. She liked to experiment with new things. But it was a contradiction, because that very freedom is what she would sacrifice for other people. Mom had 5 sisters and 2 brothers, Auntie Rhoda, Auntie Fulda, Zana, her late sisters, Auntie Doreen, Auntie Judy, Uncle Saki, and Uncle Tola. We come from a small colored township called Revelie. It's a few hundred meters away from where gold was first discovered in South Africa in 1886, there by George Harrison Park. George Harrison was the guy who found it. So this was an area where we were sitting on top of golden riches, but there was such poverty. So in Revelie, Mom shared a personal story to us when she was a teenager. And it was a life-changing moment for her. There in Kiskama Street, one day she was in tears, and she found herself sitting at the foot of those red stoops in the dust. She couldn't remember why she was crying, and she explained. But that day she made a request and a promise to God. And that request, "Please give me a man who will love you more than he loves me, and I will give you my children." That's a profound covenant for a teenager to make with God. It's profound, it's deeply profound. She could have asked, "Send me a tall, dark, and handsome man," or "Send me a man who is wealthy," or "Send me a man who will love me for me." Or she could have asked for the best deal: "Send me a good-looking, wealthy man who will love me." But Mom was no self-centered schemer. She had real depth of wisdom, and she would rather have a partner who got his identity from his heavenly Father, because such a man would be a rock. Such a man would become great. Such a man would be an example, an influence. He would have the wisdom to guide his children in the way of the Lord. And he would be a blessing to more than just her, but to so many people. And that is the wisdom in a request. It wasn't a selfish request. She wanted a man who got his identity from the Father, a man that was accountable to God, who submitted and surrendered himself to God. God must have listened. He sent her dad, Clive. He wasn't tall, but he was dark and handsome. There were days I wished my mom could have squeezed the tall part into a prayer request. Not for my benefit, for the children. She found a husband who surrendered himself completely. He pursued God. Amen. With such a diligence. And together they made the goodness of God the foundation of this home. Raising us up in His ways. God kept His promise, and so did Mom. There's a passage of scripture I just want to read as well. It's from the Passion Translation. It's John 13. And it speaks about the time just before Jesus was going to go to the cross. Now Jesus was fully aware that the Father had placed all things under his control. For he had come from God and was about to face death to go back to be with him. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer robe, took a towel and wrapped it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' dirty feet and dry them with his towel. But when Jesus got to Peter, Peter objected and said, I can't let you wash my dirty feet. You are my Lord. Jesus replied, you don't understand yet the meaning of what I am doing, but soon it will be clear to you. Peter looked at Jesus and he said, you will never wash my dirty feet, never. And Jesus said, but Peter, if you don't let me wash your feet, then you will not be able to share life with me. So Peter said, Lord, in that case, don't just wash my feet, wash my hands and my head too. And Jesus said, so if I am your teacher and Lord, and have just washed your dirty feet, then you should follow the example that I have set for you and wash one another's dirty feet. Now do for each other that which I have done for you. I speak to you a timeless truth. A servant is not superior to his master, and a messenger is never greater than the one who sent him. So now put into practice what I have done for you, and you will experience a life of happiness enriched in untold blessings. This is Mom. She put into practice the action, the activity of washing the feet of others in genuine humility. Not because it was a law, not because the Bible said so, but because that's who she was. I imagine those dirty sandals and filthy feet that were walking with Jesus. And at the time, it was common practice that a servant would be there to wash the feet of people before they ate. And while they were sitting and eating there, none of the disciples had the mind, the presence of mind, to get up and do it. At the time, they were arguing in pride of who loved Jesus more. And Jesus, in a single act of humility, recognized the need, and he acted. When Mom saw a need, she didn't ask for permission. She acted. While we were growing up, Mom and Dad saw a need in that community, that poor community, in Rivoli Extension. In a community that was worse off. So every weekend, she and Dad would mobilize people in the cause of compassion. To feed the hungry, to clothe those in need, and to minister the goodness of God. Without advertising it, without the need for glory or recognition. But because the need was great. Matthew 20, it's just carrying on with that same theme. Is it not this way among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your willing and humble servant. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many, paying the price to set them free for the penalty of sin. Sacrificial love. I think if you want to understand love, if you want to understand that love has levels, it's not an absolute. You can measure the amount of love someone has or you have for someone based on what you're willing to sacrifice. There's some people in your life that you love more than others. But my mom didn't have favorite kids, no? And the way you can measure how you love someone is based on what you're willing to sacrifice for them. Some people in your life, you might be willing to sacrifice your time to develop them, to listen, to lend a shoulder, to cry on. There are other people you might be willing to offer your talent, your skill, without any expectation of reward. The other people, you might be willing to give some of your treasure, your finances. You know, there's some people that you might borrow $100. There's some people that you borrow $1,000. And then as the number gets higher, the number of people that you're willing to borrow that, you know, 100,000 rand gets smaller and smaller. But you can measure your love based on what you're willing to sacrifice. And Jesus said, no greater love is there than this, than to lay down your life for someone you love. Mom was willing to sacrifice her spirit-free nature to become one with my dad. She let go of that wildness and that need for independence. She sacrificed so much of herself. But instead of losing herself, she gained. Her identity and source of strength was derived from agape love, the love of God. It became the source of all of the love that she could dish out. Because without that love that she got from God, she would be empty. And that's how we knew that she got her love from Him. As we talk about sacrifice, as we go up the ladder of people that you love, and it gets fewer and fewer, there are very few people that you'd be willing to give your life for. A parent may sacrifice their life for their child, a husband for his wife. But how many of us would be able to love the way God loved? He sacrificed His Son. There are very few people I've ever met that would be willing to sacrifice their child for anyone or anything. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. This is agape love. This is a level of love that none of us can give. Only your Heavenly Father can give His most prized possession in an exchange. Agape love became the cornerstone of their romantic life with Dad. It was a love covenant. It was forged in words, decisions, and actions. Finally, it was sealed by the Holy Spirit. That union was so tight that we knew after Dad passed that Mom would follow Him soon. We didn't want it to be this soon. We didn't expect it, but we knew. It doesn't make it easier, but it does make a passing sweeter. Not a day would pass when she didn't miss my dad. Until she came to a point where she said, I want to go home. At the time she was in hospice. We thought she meant geographically. But looking back, it meant more. Mom was someone who knew what she wanted, and she would get it. So we had to change our prayer from what we wanted for Mom to a maturing of our prayer life, where we said, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not what we want, but what You want. My dad called Mom Angel. She was God's temporary gift to us, Cindy, Byron, Devin, Nicole, Tech, Jade, Erin, Hannah, and soon to be appearing Adam. An angel does not belong to this world. She belongs in heaven. God kept His promise to Mom. Mom, You kept Your promise to Him. And we will make sure that the sacrificial love that you live will not end here today. We will put into the practice the example of sacrificial love that you inherited from Jesus. We promise to wash each other's dirty feet whenever we see the need. Thank you for a fine example of how to show love. We will miss you with pain, but with sweetness.
Alpha and Omega, create his next song. I still don't know it, but we're going to sing it. Those of you know, let's stand. I have to put that fan on because this project has been very temperamental, and I've been praying that you see it flickering.
And don't let gospel.
Whoever thought Fred would be teaching us new songs here at Emmanuel? Wonderful. Please be seated. I've already said a lot about Fred today, and Earl, what a wonderful, wonderful tribute. From a church at Yared Emmanuel, from a brotherhood, sisterhood in Christ, from a Christian perspective, to me, our dear sister Frieda is a model of one who lived her best for Jesus. Frieda was quiet here at church, but those are the people who get the job done. I'm sure by Frieda's own admission, less than perfect, yet by testimony and witness, we know Frieda lived the best she could for her Jesus. And in living for Jesus, Frieda lived for her dearest Clive, for her beloved children and grandchildren, her family and friends, a testimony to all who knew her, and also to the stranger too. I didn't sit here and write this up in conjunction with what Earl was going to say, because this is the truth. This is who Frieda was. This is not trying to talk somebody up. It's just who Frieda was. I said this at Clive's funeral and I say it again. Solomon in Proverbs wrote this: who can find a virtuous woman? For her, for Frieda's price is far above rubies. The truth is, there's no price. The only price was the blood of Jesus. The heart of a husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. You've heard the testimony. You've seen it yourself. We saw the sermon. We never had to hear it. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth amongst the elders of the land. Strength and honor are hers. Strength and honor are Frieda's clothing. And she shall rejoice in time to come, even as she rejoices today in the glory. Crowns, many crowns, I am certain, from Jesus. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou, Frieda, excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. How can we truly honor and pay our respects to Frieda today? I'll tell you. I'll tell you right now. It is to know Jesus like Frieda knew Jesus. You want to pay her honor and respect? Maybe you've drifted afar. Maybe your anchor came loose from the rock of Christ. Today, let it take hold in Jesus. You want to honor Frieda? When you're out there in your community, do as she did. Do good unto others. And in so doing, do it in the name of Jesus. I'll tell you, to pay our respects to her, get real with Jesus. And so it behoves me, not knowing you all present, to give you the opportunity to know Frieda's Savior and Redeemer, her healer and her friend. Oh, her healer, but she died of cancer. My friends, she died at Christ's appointed time. That's what she did. Cancer was just the means. She never railed at God for it. She loved him throughout it all. Present you today the opportunity of salvation in Christ Jesus. the forgiveness of your sin, and the receiving of eternal life through Christ Jesus' redemptive gift of salvation. And to give you the opportunity, if you are born again, to find anew your faith, to maybe make that commitment on that red stoop there in the dust. I will serve you the best I can. No great feat needs to be formed. No great deeds have to be done. All the Lord asks for is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. So I'm going to pray a simple prayer of salvation. For those of you saved and born again, pray it aloud with me as a renewal of your bond and your vow with Jesus Christ the righteous. And if you've never prayed a prayer like this before, even as a thief on the cross said, "We're the sinners. Lord, remember me today in paradise." Jesus said, "You'll be with me." Amen. Pray this prayer, my friend. Pray it in sincerity to receive Him as Savior for the first time or to renew your bond. Let's bow our heads as we pray. I will read it and you pray after me, if you wish. Heavenly Father, I come to you confessing that I am a sinner and that I need your salvation. I believe that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is your Son, that He dwelt on this earth, that He died on the cross for the forgiveness of my sins, that He was buried and rose again for my justification. I now receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior, as my healer, master and friend. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Thank you for giving me eternal life. I will try my best to serve you for the rest of my life. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we too can know you. Help us, Lord, in our times of weakness, to be reminded of the wonderful strength and faith of Frieda and of Clive and of this family, that, Lord, we should always come to you and stay close by your side. Bless each one here today, in Jesus' name. Amen. On conclusion of the service, just a few formalities. First of all, again, thank you everyone for being here. To the funeral services, Kurz, for all that you've done. There's caterers who've catered wonderful food, I believe, for us outside, so you're all invited to stay on and enjoy a meal. Praise the Lord, we don't have to worry about COVID. Yes, it's still there, but I pray the blood of Jesus over each one of us, that nobody today should contract it. Thank you also to Emmanuel Church, Uncle Pete Carter, the congregation, Clarence. If you saw the state of this church yesterday morning, it was a building site. Clarence and Portia and Uncle Pete and Auntie Jill and my daughter Storm and some other chaps got in here and cleaned and cleaned and cleaned. So we're busy renovating the church, making some changes so that we can extend our services and to enjoy our fellowship together. It was time to paint the church. Now it's painted. So, and we're also changing our service time to 9 o'clock. But we're going through some changes. We have a wonderful new pastor, Rory Watts, and his wife, his handmaiden, Sister Leanne. And the Lord's going to do wonderful things. Even as you've been able to fellowship here today, the church lives on, always, in its people. So please come and enjoy some fellowship. We're going to do a committal. We're then going to close with a closing hymn. And then, folks, you see some stickers on Frieda's coffin. If any of you have also got stickers, please write them up and come and put it on the coffin before it is taken away. Frieda's going to be cremated. Those stickers will be burned. But imagine them as a sweet, savouring offering of your prayers, your kind words ascending to the heavenlies as you remembered, even in writing. Frieda, I read, I think it's Jade's words there. The very kind words. Bless you. To your own. Wonderful. So I'm going to ask the family who'd like to come and stand with me at Mom's coffin. As we commit her. Congregation, please stand. From dust we are, and so to dust we must return, declares the Holy Scriptures. But Job gives us this blessed assurance, a man who lived long before Jesus Christ and looked forward to the salvation and the redemption and the finished work of the cross. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. I'm going to read a poem, Frieda. It's a beautiful hymn. Hymns are songs of offering, praise, as we remember your dear mom. O love that will not let me go, I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer, fuller be. O light that flickerest, O light that follows all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray, that in thy sunshine's blazed day may brighter, fairer be. O joy that seekest me through pain, I cannot close my heart to thee. I trace the rainbow through the rain, and feel the promise is not vain, that morn shall tearless be. O cross that liftest up my head, I dare not ask to fly from thee. I lay in dust life's glory dead, and from the ground there blossoms red life that shall endless be. Frieda, rest in peace, our dear sister, our mom, our Oma. As you have soared to your glory, as the angels took you home, so we too rejoice that you're at peace forever. Till we meet again, God bless you. God bless you all. Amen. You can be seated.
let's stand in the closing hymn, The Goodness of God. This one I'll do. My wife has taught our youth many songs, and this is one of them. Oh, we've lost the words.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you.
Lord bless thee and keep thee. Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace all the days of your life. The Lord bless you as you join the family for fellowship. Outside we can open this door and the bathrooms are through the back. There'll be refreshments. Thank you, folks. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for sharing us. May the Lord bless you abundantly. Amen.
This one is these. Yeah, I think we can stop this one. This one we can stop.